Imagine that you're in a car or truck going really fast down the Autobahn, or on a salt lake flat, salt flat in the Mojave Desert, and you're going 120, 130, 140. Now, at that point, do you like reach for a hamburger? Say, oh, let me have this. I'm gonna start eating this hamburger, and oh, there's a milkshake over here. Let me start drinking this, and oh, the radio. Let me turn the radio on. Oh, there's another. Let me tune this. I'm gonna change the channel. Change the channel. Let me tune this. Adjust the volume here. Let me adjust my mirrors. Let me start singing. Let me start carousing here. Is that what you do when you're going maximum speed, 140 miles an hour, or are you locked in, very disciplined, very focused, realizing the slightest, lack of attention, you could perish. It's you're in a very intense situation. So, what do you do? Of course, if you're going really fast, you find your attention focus, discipline, focusing in. You're not taking drugs. You're not smoking a joint. You're not with some giggling companion. You're not being distracted. What happens when those things take place? Car crash, of course, of course. It happens to many, many people. So it's the same way on the spiritual path. Similar, it's similar. We're going very fast now, so it requires discipline. Requires discipline. Man, part of managing your success on the path for all of us is discipline. That's why all the religious institutions of throughout history support success on the spiritual path, success, and therefore they realize you must manage your success. You have to go fast on the spiritual path. You have to go fast. So you have to be disciplined. You have to be disciplined. Otherwise, the wheels are going to come off. You're going to get, you're going to turn over and over and over on some side trip. That's why the disciplines that we see in all spiritual traditions, you might say, have fundamental disciplines that you say you must discipline your life. That's the only way you're going to build up the necessary speed to finally reach escape velocity from this delusion, the simulated delusion that we have, trying to help us get familiar with what we believe the kingdom of time is going to be like once we think there is going to be a kingdom of time. And in order to get free of this and change our purpose for the simulation, this requires you feel like you're going really fast, really, really fast. Every day is just the breakthroughs are more and more and more and more and more. So you have to manage your success on the path. The whole idea of taking the path, you're getting somewhere, really important. And as you do this, you will find you get, hey, I'm getting closer and closer and closer and closer and closer. And you're going to feel more and more and more pressure, more and more speed, more and more attraction to the goal. It's inevitable. So there isn't any spiritual path without discipline. So the world is what it's doing now is it believes that time's about to start. The kingdom of time is about to be inaugurated. And so they're trying to shake off all discipline entirely. And they're saying, we don't need that. That will hinder our freedom in the kingdom of time. It will hinder our enjoyment of the kingdom of time. They want to just let it all hang out and do whatever feels good, whatever feels right for them. It's all, but remember, the kingdom of time, we're simulating it. This is a simulation. There won't ever be a kingdom of time, but how we believe it will be is body-based. It has to be. The kingdom of time would have to be body-based. Time, space, process, and form-based. It would have to be. And so they're trying to get satisfaction through bodies. Bodies, 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 bodies. I need more fashion. I need more attraction. I need more glamour. I need more freedom to I need open relationships so I can. I need a hookup culture. I need intense hookup culture. I need the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, hookup culture, do whatever I feel like doing, and no discipline, no restrictions. I want to indulge the body in every way possible. And they feel that this is how the kingdom of time is going to be. So they're very intensely into simulating what, so they can feel familiar, so they can feel not, so they don't have a continuity problem. Once they believe the kingdom of time starts, they'll be able to say, oh yeah, this is very similar to what I've been experiencing, so I can fit right in. I can fit right in. This is the trouble of the times, and so they're vilifying, demonizing discipline, mocking it. They feel this is something they need to rid themselves of, any attraction to self-discipline altogether. Otherwise, they won't be able to enjoy the kingdom of time. And if they don't enjoy it, they feel they're going to get in all sorts of problems with, you know, and they're terrified of, oh my gosh, what happens if I don't enjoy it? You know, I might choose to be in, you know, to drop it, and then I'll be annihilated because there isn't anything else. And they fear attraction back to reality. Fear attraction back to reality. And of course, they believe once the kingdom of time starts, there isn't going to be any reality. This will now supplant reality. So they're terrified of, you know, how can I be loyal to the kingdom, and how do I be loyal? I have to be happy. How do I be happy? Well, I gotta shop. I gotta be like a super shopper, and a super fornicator, and a super partier, and a super drug addict, and I need to be happy. And if I'm not happy, oh my God, I'm going to be thrown into the lake of everlasting fire. You know, so this is what's going on right now, and so it's very difficult for us to maintain our discipline. It's being vilified. All the discipline of the spirit, various spiritual traditions, are now being vilified. Since Christianity has more people involved in it than any other tradition, that's the one who's being highlighted and targeted. But they're really targeting all spiritual traditions, which have to do with self-discipline. Self-discipline is super important. Again, the analogy of driving faster and faster and faster. You know, when you start doing that, what do? You turn off the radio. Right? You say, wait a minute. I can't be singing along with this song and being distracted by this music. Click, off goes the radio. I can't have some giggling companion, you know, messing with me as I'm driving. So, no companion in the car like that. Okay, I can't be eating a bunch of food, stuffing my face with. So none of that. Drugs. I can't be on drugs while I'm driving really fast. So out with that, you know. So out with all these distractions. You automatically say, wow. I mean, you don't see these race car drivers with all these distractions minimize it, right? They try to minimize it. They're very, just a split second of inattention, you know, is the difference between a crash and not a crash. So the advice here is spiritual advice, discipline, spiritual discipline, in order to help you manage your success. It's not advice for those who are trying to get ready for the kingdom of time. Okay, it's not advice for them at all, because they're not interested in this goal at all. They're pursuing a false mirage of a goal. It's a mirage. The belief that time is going to start is you're continually advancing towards this mirage, thinking that the mirage is going to become true at some point. It never becomes true. So on the spiritual path, it's a path of self-discipline. And the faster you go, the more self-discipline you need. So you have to cut out all body thoughts in your mind. You have to be ruthless with your thoughts and your imagination, your attention. Ruthless. And any time the mind starts going toward body thoughts, you know, you just have to absolutely cut that thought off immediately. And this is a daily, moment-by-moment discipline. Moment-by-moment discipline. In reality, there are no bodies, okay? And reality is all there is. So body thoughts lead nowhere. The only reason we have body thoughts is we believe that the time is going to start, and it's going to supplant reality and be the new kingdom of heaven, time. And in time, we have to be a body. So we have to have body thoughts, and we have to be totally focused on body thoughts. This is what our logic tells us. If time were to start, then this is what it would be like. So we're practicing getting ready for the kingdom of time by having body thoughts. But because the kingdom of time will never start at all, these body thoughts are useless to us, useless. And they drastically interfere with preparing to realize that time will never start. Because when we're having body thoughts, we logically say, well, the reason I'm having these body thoughts must be because time is going to start. Why else would I have them? You see? And so we easily trick ourselves this way. We think it's logical. We say, well, yeah, this, of course, like we look at this world. Well, the reason why this world is the way it is, because obviously time is going to start. Why else would there be this world helping me prepare for it? Because we are dreaming it up to simulate the start of time, because we want time to start. See, in our arrogance, we want time to start because that will prove that we're greater than God. So there's two standards here. One is the standards of the spiritual path, spiritual discipline, and the other is the standard for those who are trying to prepare for time to start. And this is why you have this dichotomy in the world of religious traditions and institutions and then secular culture. Okay. And the two have completely different directions, completely different purposes. And ultimately, which one needs to be ascendant? Traditions of spiritual culture need to be ascendant, because they know, they're bounded by those who know that time will never start. So all of this simulation to try to get ready for time is meaningless. It goes nowhere. It goes nowhere. And puts us through all sorts of misery and suffering, because this is part of the logic of preparing for time. We feel that these are the troubles that we will run into when we're in the kingdom of time. So secular culture is pursuing a mirage. It's simply pursuing a mirage. And this is very well known by the adepts who have started and supported these institutions of self-discipline. And again, which is on the right, which is representing reality, self-discipline, traditions of religious traditions of self-discipline. Those are the ones that are helping direct you towards reality. Now, when you try to be self-disciplined, you get ridiculed here, because you say, ah, what a square. You're not hip. You don't know what's hip. When time starts, you'll be completely ostracized. You won't know how to function there. You know, you'll be a homeless, derelict, non-functional, completely, no one will give you a second thought, the time of day, because you're not hip. You don't know how to flow with time. You don't know how to get into your body. You know, so they ridicule and mock you and tell you, kind of warning you, like, you know, you're really going to be a loser. You're going to be the ultimate loser if you don't, you know, try to get hip with how to function in time. And so you think, wow, you know, this is terrible. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? Of course, they're the ones who are going to continue with their unhipness, not knowing how to function in reality. See, they don't know how to function in reality. They're the ones who feel ostracized and estranged and alienated from reality, because they don't know how to function in reality. There's no bodies in reality. There's no form in reality at all. And so the more we focus on body thoughts, the more we feel estranged from reality, like we don't know how to function. Well, and so we make a boogeyman of reality, like, oh, you know, that's scary. How can you function that way? I don't know how to function that way. So how this will all shake out is, I don't know. There has to be an end game, end run around all of this. What's happening in the world right now is basically secular culture, which is time preparation culture, body thought culture, is trying to wipe out spiritual tradition, wipe out self-discipline, and demonize it, and criminalize it, and execute it ultimately, annihilate it. And so this is a very, very unsettled time right now we live in. You know, the idea of separation between church and state goes both ways, right? What it means is secular culture says church should not completely dominate, and the church says secular culture should not interfere in the business of the church. What it means, self-discipline. And the self-discipline of spiritual institutions and traditions are a complete anathema to the time worshippers and time preparers. Complete anathema to them. And so they say, you know, they can't stand any longer living under any shadow of self-discipline at all. But what about those then who are on the spiritual path to recognizing, preparing for time not to start, which is the right path to be on? Absolutely. This is not chasing mirage. It's getting reconciled back unto functioning in reality, which everyone must do. So it's an essential, must do, non-optional path. Okay, whereas preparing for time is entirely optional. It's a whimsical. It's not necessary at all. It's an elective, not a requirement. It's just whimsical, wishful, fanciful thinking. You know, it's ego tripping. So that is not required or necessary. So it's kind of like in school. You know, there's certain courses you have to take in order to graduate, and the other stuff, well, you know, electives, you can take whatever you want to take if you want to. You know, if you want to take pottery making, whatever. But it's not essential to graduate. It's the same thing with us here. The spiritual path, which requires self-discipline, which requires knocking out body thoughts, is essential. It's essential. So what you can say is the essential has to be in charge, and they can allow electives, they can allow a certain amount of non-discipline, but it should not be focused on. It shouldn't be the focus of our attention. It should not be the focus of our attention. If people want to goof off, they should recognize they're outside the mainstream. They're absolutely outside the norm and the mainstream. This is how it has to be. So there's tolerance, but it's fundamentally recognized and legally recognized as outside the mainstream, outside the norm, and is not to be given attention. And this is just basic wisdom, basic pragmatism. But right now, there's this ferocious belief that time is about to start. So those who are time worshippers are feeling very emboldened, not more emboldened, they're desperate to shake off all self-discipline. That's why you have all these pagan parades now, and they're celebrating lack of self-discipline, celebrating it, and encouraging everybody else to join in and say, look how non-disciplined, look how obsessed I am with body thoughts. You need to have the same level of obsession. And they're trying to pull everybody into this, pull everybody down into hell, essentially. The hell of preparing for time to start. That's what hell is preparing for time to start. That's hell. And they're trying to pull everyone down into hell with them. Because for them, you know, everybody's just a body, and body thoughts are life, you know. And so if someone's all disciplined and ascetic, you know, and non-responsive to this, they think, hey, you're interfering with my happiness. You know, no, I got to party with you. You got to party with me. We all got to party together. I mean, if you don't want to party, you're interfering with my happiness. You know, you're interfering with my comfort zone in time. You know, this is what they're worried about. So basically, they're demanding that you party with them. This is what I experienced growing up as this time worshiping began to become frantic. Everybody demanded that you party with them. Not everyone, but the time worshippers. And it was this intense pressure. Everybody demanded that you, you know, have body thoughts. Everybody demanded that you, you know, be accessible to them and their way of thinking like that. And of course, now this has now been being codified in law around the world. It's all around the world now. It has been codified in law. With some exception, that basically it's demanded of you that you party with the time worshippers. It's demanded of you that you have body thoughts. It's demanded of you that you celebrate body thoughts and celebrate lack of self-discipline. This is now a legal demand, actually, and you're criminalized if you don't. And so this has not been the case throughout history here. So this is a very unique situation now. It's called the end times. It's called the end times. When this, the legal code of the planet will actually now support time worshiping and criminalize non-time worshiping, non-time preparations. It'll support that it'll support the belief that time is about to start. And those who say that time will never start, it will criminalize that belief. And so this is what the prophets understood. They knew that this time would come. And they're very aware that this time is now here. It's absolutely here. When you have a country like Ireland, which used to be supposedly is very self-disciplined, at least this is what they represented. Now criminalize self-discipline. Criminalize it, you see. That's you know, extreme example, but it's that way all over the world. Perfect example. Okay, here's a perfect example. Sex, okay. The right discipline on sex is only in for the purposes of procreation between a man and a woman. That's it. Anything else is fornication. It's a sin, plain and simple. This is a standard self-discipline throughout history. And this is a very important self-discipline because it limits body thoughts, doesn't it? It limits the spread of glamour, body glamour, and body thoughts and body fixation. Only for the purposes of procreation and for no other purpose and only between a man and woman, period. No exceptions. That's just basic self-discipline. Drugs, no drugs. Pornography, no pornography under any circumstances. Divorce, no divorce. Okay, no divorce. Why? Because what happens in marriage is you get bored of the thrill of body, the body thoughts get bored, blah, and you stop having body thoughts, you know, and which is a good thing. It's a great thing. Marriage is actually a very great help. Sometimes the great saints have told us that marriage can be a better discipline than being a monk or a nun, actually. They can get lazy. But in marriage, you're constantly faced with this boredom of the marriage and then that provides a tremendous motivation for you to work on the spiritual path and be very disciplined. So actually being a household or being married can be, you know, the greatest discipline of all. So there are some who are given to be the renunciate life of a monk or a nun. And then the advice of the others is to marry. Absolutely get to marry. And this becomes a tremendous discipline for you. Okay. And so when you get bored of the thrill of the marriage, you know, then you don't divorce. You don't divorce at all. You use it then as the institution to maintain your self-discipline and work on the spiritual path. So that's why a divorce is an anathema. And in this hookup culture we have now, is now divorce is just like completely rampant. In fact, it's a rite of initiation among the pagan time worshippers to show how liberated they are and how ready for time they are. And so basically people have these, you know, open marriage live-in situation that, you know, well, whenever we feel that there's a little bit of lack of body attraction in the marriage, we'll go to someone else like that. Okay, this is an absolute anathema, okay, in all spiritual tradition. You know, when the fire, the spark of attraction is gone in the marriage, which it always does, great. Now, stay within that discipline, okay, within that situation, and spend your time then knocking out all body thoughts, knocking out all body thoughts, knocking out all preparation for time, changing the simulation for preparation for time not to start, time to never start, time to never start. So marriage, in no way is marriage an impediment to you changing, making this choice of change of purpose for the simulation. In no way is it an impediment. It's oftentimes not being married that's the impediment. If you're not married, then you'd be absolutely celibate and be a renunciate. Okay, those are the two. Those are the options that society should give us. Either you be in marriage or you be a renunciate, plain and simple. Those should be the two options. And the rest is simply irresponsible, non-mainstream, non-normal, irresponsible, decadent, hellish culture that are trying to prepare for time and should not be given any attention at all. In mainstream society, mainstream culture, absolutely not. This is the way it's been throughout history for a super important reason. Because we're tired of hell, the hell of preparing for time. And we don't want it to continue on. We want to change our purpose of the simulation. What is the simulation? This universe of electromagnetic universe is a imaginary simulation that spirit is imagining. The mind of spirit is imagining all of this as if it were a way to get ready for the kingdom of time, because we're imagining that this might be similar. We don't know, because there's never been any kingdom of time, but we're just following this logic of arrogance that tells us that this, you know, do this might be similar. This, we believe we might have an idea of how the kingdom of time would be, so this might be similar. And of course, we've come up with, you know, time, space, process, and form. Bodies, time, space, process, and form. All a fanciful, wishful thinking, believing that this might be similar to what the kingdom of time would be like. So we feel that somehow it's beneficial, has some value to us. The way that we're seeing it has some value to us. It's preparing us to function in the kingdom of time. But because there isn't ever going to be any kingdom of time, it doesn't really have any value at all. So what do you do with it? Well, we're afraid to just completely drop this universe just like that, right? Continuity problem. We're so used to pretending and imagining and simulating and preparing that we're afraid, you know, afraid to drop all of that. So let's prepare for something else. Let's maintain this notion of simulation and preparation. Use this simulation or give it a different purpose, which because it's our own dream, we can do that. It's easy. Our dream will absolutely obey us. You think when you're in a dream, when you're dreaming, that you decide you're going to change the way the dream is, that it doesn't obey you? Of course it obeys you. Has to. Has no choice. I've experienced that in dreams where I've been in a situation where it's very problematical and terrible. And then somehow I feel in a dream, you know what? I don't want this. Let me shift the entire context just completely. And then suddenly just everything changes in the dream. And I realize, wow, I have complete authority over this dream. I literally changed the ocean, the mountains, the landscape, everything in the dream. So I have complete authority over this dream. And each one is dreaming their own dream of the universe, really. Perception, each one is unique. So we have the authority to change the purpose of the simulation. And now, the simulation will totally support, give me sacred support for preparing, to help me prepare, sacred support to help me prepare to fully realize that time will never start. There'll never be a kingdom of time. Not even for one instant will there ever be a kingdom of time. Never. Time will never start. So now I have a simulation of a universe of that gives me continuous sacred support for my preparation and to help me prepare to fully realize that that time will never start, there'll never be a kingdom of time. And I don't need one iota of know-how to function in the kingdom of time. I don't need any know-how whatsoever. And this will not in any way interfere with my functioning in reality. That the fact that I don't have any know-how of how to function in the kingdom of time will not have any interference whatsoever. So obviously, to prepare for this, we need to experience something very different than what we're experiencing right now with this simulation of this universe preparing us. Now, we don't need a different quote-unquote universe, so to speak. Just like we don't have to awaken from a dream in order to give the dream a different purpose. We can still be dreaming, but give the dream a different purpose. Absolutely, we can do that. So we don't need to stop simulating. We don't need to stop imagining. We don't need to stop preparing. We can simply give a different purpose to our imagining, to our simulating, and our preparing. And then we have this easy waking up from the dream where we feel completely assured that we don't need to have even a speck of know-how about how to prepare for time, how to function in time. It's not needed at all to function in reality. And then we will have no fear at all to set down all the simulation, preparation, imagination, which isn't needed in reality at all. Okay, we don't need to prepare to experience in reality. All experiencing is all right now. And it's just simply known. It is simply known. There's no need to prepare for any experiencing. But that's beyond the scope of what we need to do. We need to give the dream a different purpose. We need to give the simulation a different purpose, and we absolutely have total sovereign authority to do that. And this simulation will absolutely obey the purpose that we give to it. We just haven't tried it yet. We haven't used our will to really say, okay, this is now what we want. We may have tried a few times and then said, whoa, but if I have this, how can I gain know-how to function in time? Because I have all the sacred support, which will be not a trace of non-support for me. There will not be even a trace of non-support for my presence here in the dream. I have complete sacred support. No non-support whatsoever. Not a trace of any non-support. But then we think, wait a minute, you know, how can I learn how to function in a place with non-support, the non-support of time? And then you think, and then you think, wow, I better have both, and then you're really in trouble. That's the compromise that really drags us into hell. The hell of mental chaos, actually. That's the hell. That's the worst hell. The lowest point of hell is total mental chaos. I've been there. I know exactly what that's about. And that's why I'm telling people so emphatically, don't try to have this balance or compromise between, you know how knowing how to function in the kingdom of time and knowing how to function in the kingdom of reality. timelessness, you will end up with total mental chaos in trying to do that. Now, you can glamorize this path, make it seem beautiful and attractive, which of course we have to because it's so scary. We say, wait a minute, I think this is going to cause me a severe problem. Well, we glamorize, keep glamorizing it, and eventually then we hit rock bottom and say, uh-oh, this doesn't work. This will never work. So our fear is when we get these glimpses of total sacred support, and I mean this literally, where you're so supported by this universe is so supportive of you, you don't even need to be a body. That's how supportive it is of you. Hard to understand, but this body is really a symbol of belief in non-support. That we believe we need this body to get support. We need to somehow get special support. And to simulate lack of support. Simulating lack of support, but potential for lack of support. It's a symbol of lack of support. So the universe, when we change our purpose and we prepare fully realize that time will never start, we get full support from the universe for our being. Full support. There's no non-support at all. And then you realize, like, wow, I don't even need a body, a symbol of non-support. It's not even necessary anymore. I don't need to learn how to function with non-support. The universe is completely supportive of me, always will be. Not a trace of non-support anywhere. So then the symbol of non-support is superfluous. It's nothing. It's not needed. But even that is paradox. Even that is the body still feels, you still feel support for it. It's because it's your temporary chosen symbol, your favorite symbol. The universe even supports that. You can still have a body, absolutely. And the body will feel completely supported. You'll feel that there's no non-support for the body whatsoever. It will function just how you need it to function. It's like a car. It's like you realize that you can be anywhere instantly. So why do you need a car to get there? Get anywhere. You realize, I don't really need a car at all. But then you might say, yeah, well, just for the sake of honoring my creativity, I still want to cruise for a while in the car sometimes. I want to feel like I'm just cruising along, going somewhere. So sure. So what happens? Well, the car is in perfect condition then for you. Perfect condition. So there's no possibility that you can't enjoy cruising somewhere, going somewhere. It'll be smooth and flawless and say, oh yeah, this, you want to, you're reminiscing, but you also realize, yeah, I could also be there instantly. You see, just honoring our creativity a little bit, that's to also support it. But the support is so perfect that you realize I don't really, need a body, but pragmatically it's helpful for others to see this, so that's fine. I'll keep a body for a little while. But I don't need any body thoughts to maintain this body. I don't need any body thoughts at all. I need take no thought for this body at all. And it's totally supported. The whole universe absolutely gives sacred, complete sacred support every moment without any lapse whatsoever. So now we're getting to the nitty-gritty of what these great teachers have told us. And, I wish they'd done a better job in explaining it, but for some reason we weren't really ready for that. But now we are ready for it, so we're getting this better explanation. Holy Spirit is clarifying it all. Like Jesus said, look at the lilies, look how they, don't give any thought, and they're still, the rain falls for them, everything's fine for them, and take no thought for your body either. And people say, well, wait a minute, what about when droughts come, and they don't get the rain and the plants die, or someone comes and chops them down, or but he was just using an analogy, a metaphor kind of thing, but it was really had a deeper meaning to it. But of course, when we're preparing for time, we don't get this sacred support at all. Of course, that's the whole idea of preparing for the King of Time, is you're not supported. You're fundamentally non-supported, actually. You're fundamentally on the edge of famine and drought and attack and all this. That's the whole point of preparing for the kingdom of time. But remember, this is all a dream simulation that we're totally in charge of. God's not in charge of it. We are. God did not dream this dream of simulating what time is going to be like, because God knows there's no such thing as time. So why would God dream a dream preparing us, theoretically, simulating what the kingdom of time would be like so that we can prepare for this advent of the kingdom of time, when God knows perfectly well there isn't ever going to be any kingdom of time? That would be an atrocious thing for God to do. It would be deceiving the Son, deceiving Spirit, because the Spirit would say, well, if God created all this, you know, universe here that simulates the kingdom of time, that means God must know that the kingdom of time is going to start. Therefore, we must get used to this. All the while, God knowing the kingdom of time is never going to start, what kind of atrocious deception would that be from God? That's absolutely insane. Of course, God never did such a thing. The idea this is all God's handiwork is absolute nonsense. This is Spirit's handiwork, okay, the Son of God's handiwork. And this is the problem when people think that they say that there's no Trinity to God. This is the problem they run into. They say, no, this must be God's handiwork. And they say, why the heck would God do that? Well, God's just playing a crazy game with himself, you know. Well, why is God playing a crazy game with himself? Is God crazy? No. So this is the problem that you run into when you don't have the Trinity. Huge problem. Fundamentally, there is a Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. This is true. There's God the prime creator, and then Spirit the prime created, and then the Holy Spirit, that which is, it's really an aspect. It's a blessing upon God the Son. It's a blessing upon God the prime created, which is an assurance that God did not create all this. Simulation. What the Holy Spirit really is God's assurance to God the prime created, which is God the Son, God the Spirit, that God did not create the simulation. That's what it is. It's an assurance. So the Trinity is very important. Otherwise, you run into some trouble. You run into troubles, ultimately. Because you say, wait, this is all God's handiwork? You say, well, you know, what? Is God a lunatic? I mean, that's crazy. No, God's just having fun hiding from himself and stuff like this. No, that's not true. That is absolutely not true. God played no role at all, direct role in terms of this simulation. He gave the Son of God pure freedom, absolute freedom. That's what God is, absolute freedom. So the God creates like God unto himself. And that means all is given absolute freedom. But God knew that this absolute freedom could be used to try and change reality, to try to restrict itself. And so God then gave this absolute assurance that it never created any restriction whatsoever. And this is not a game of God. That the game that we get into of simulating the start of time is our own choice of our own, from our own freedom, the freedom of spirit, to do this. And God is not simulating this at all for us. It's our dream, not God's dream. It's very important. Trinity is very important. This this is what Jesus emphasized to me when I had a visit with him. And I didn't quite understand what he was saying, but he said, no, and I was talking about, well, maybe we need to have a lot of different aspects. And he said, no, just three, just three. Just, he emphasized this over and over and over to me. Just three is that's, you need the three. You need the, that's exactly where it's at. This is what I teach, the Trinity. God the prime creator, which created the direction of creation of absolute freedom. God the prime created, which is fully free to experience all this freedom. And then God the Holy Spirit, which assures God the freedom of expression. God the Spirit, God the Son. It assures it that God did not ever create any of this simulation for the start of time. This is not will never be the work of God. And that way we say, oh, okay, yeah, it's my own dream, therefore I have total sovereign control over a dream, therefore I can give this dream a different purpose, right? And I can use it to prepare me for the full realization that time will never start. I can do this. Because if God created this simulation for a dream, we couldn't change it. We wouldn't be able to change it. And therefore we'd feel we have to work within this dream. And this is where all the problems come. So many problems on the spiritual path have to do with a lack of understanding of the Trinity. Absolutely they do. A lack of clear understanding of the Trinity, it brings up a hornet's nest of problems, really. Because then they think, well, wow, if I want to change this dream, I've got to change God's will. And when that brings up, then that just emphasizes the belief in time. That time will start. Because if God is changed in any way, that's the start of time. Plain and simple. So we think there's some like secret that God has to help us manipulate this dream or something. We have to find out the secret. This is all nonsense. There's no secret we need to learn at all. There's no need for any esotericism whatsoever. This is 100% a dream simulation that we are imagining, spirit. There's no dynamics of God involved in this whatsoever. Other than our pure freedom, that we have the freedom to do this. But, you know, but other, and the Holy Spirit assures us that this is not a stumbling block for us, okay? Don't blame God, you know, for our absolute freedom, because we can say, well, if we didn't have absolute freedom, then we couldn't have done this, you know. So that's the one, you know, aspect of reality that we need to be clear about, that we do have absolute freedom, including we have the freedom to imagine that we might not be free, but it's only 100% pure our imagination. It is not the imagination of God. God is not imagining that we're not free or that God is not free. That is not true. We are imagining it. The Son of God is imagining it. That's why Jesus insisted he was the Son of God, but that God the Father was greater. He insisted upon that. And then he also insisted he was sending us the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, which is the third part of the Trinity. He said, this is not me. I'm going to recede in the background a little bit, and this other aspect of God is going to be, is the reassurer, the great reassurer. Okay, so we have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. This is true, accurate, factual teaching. And I know that the other, you know, traditions like Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, they don't go for that. Although Hinduism does, to a certain extent, actually, it does have its own Trinity. Shiva, Brahma, and Vishnu, something like that. They do have actually a Trinity. Islam is a strict monotheism, which says God, it doesn't have three aspects at all, just one. And then in Buddhism, that says, well, there is no God at all, so to speak. Basically, strict monotheism there too, in a lot of ways. But the Christian tradition, coming from Jesus, absolutely emphasizes that there is a Trinity, and from what I see, this is essential. It's essential to recognize this. put another way, it certainly makes it a heck of a lot easier to get free of delusion. And you don't have to go through all these mental manipulations and esoteric and twist yourself in the knots. You just plain and simply decide to choose a different purpose for the simulation. That's all. One simple choice is all. Is all. As Jesus said, choose once again. And of course in miracles, choose once again. That's all you have to do. Choose a different purpose for this dream. That's all. And Jesus insists we are the ones who have absolute sovereign control over this dream entirely. So our word is authority in this dream, total authority. All we need to do is assert, okay, this is the purpose I want this dream to serve now, and that's exactly what the simulation will serve. The entire universe of simulation will be there for you to serve the purpose of preparing to realize that time will never start. And again, in my talk with visiting with Jesus, he kept emphasizing this, the Trinity kept emphasizing, says, and I kept saying, well, you know, maybe four or five or six is better, or, you know, I was like, kind of like wishy-washy, and he said, no, three is all you need, three is all you need, that's it, just focus on the Trinity, that's all you need, be very clear about that. And I was very amazed by this, but I took it to heart. You know, I said, okay, I mean, this must be true, because this is what he's emphasizing to me. So I would advise those who have the belief in the Trinity to absolutely hold on to that belief. It's very important, extremely helpful. And those who don't have that belief, I would advise them to maintain their disciplines of their tradition. Okay, maintain the disciplines, keep managing their success. Really, the most of those traditions, they're based on practice and discipline, practice, and then their way of looking at it is, if you learn to manage your success and you keep discipline and practice, you'll eventually reach the truth. And this is true. It is true. Whereas Christianity also has that, maintain your discipline, manage your success, but it also has the theory of the Trinity, which provides this overall context, and I find that even more helpful. But in no way does that denigrate the helpfulness of the other traditions at all, because they can also arrive at the truth, because you have to learn to manage your success. This is the key component. It's just that when you get to this point of needing the sacred support, that's where the Trinity, the teaching of the Trinity, is so important. You don't stall out. You don't stall out. What I've seen in other traditions is there's a stalling out at a certain point. And you go into intellectualism. There's a stall out that happens. And what I see is this understanding of the Trinity enables you to just smoothly just go past that stall out. Not a problem at all. Not a problem at all. God had nothing to do with this simulation whatsoever. So I'm not changing the will of God by changing the purpose of the simulation. Not in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. in like, for instance, Buddhism, they try to get around this problem by saying, well, there is no God, so don't worry about it. You can change the simulation because the simulation is causeless. All is causeless, you know. They try to get around it in that way. But for me, I the Trinity seems to be a much better way to deal with this issue of how do you change the purpose of the simulation. Not to say that the other ways cannot work. Obviously they have in some instances, but there is this conundrum there that ends up making the tradition way more complex than it needs to be, actually. Are way more aggressive than it needs to be, or way more, you know, it weighs down the tradition and the institutions I feel. It really weighs them down and makes it quite difficult. Now, but with this Trinity teaching, if this is taught properly, it simplifies the tradition. Simplifies it. It lightens it up to a tremendous extent. If the Trinity teaching is taught correctly. So in meeting with Jesus and just talking with him like a friend, just visiting, he emphasizes over and over and over and over. So this is certainly where he's coming from. And he certainly sees it as this ultimately is how to simplify and lighten up the spiritual path for everybody, is the proper teaching of the Trinity. The proper teaching of this makes it way easier to attain equality with Jesus, which is the only way you're going to do that is to feel total sacred support from the entire universe, being absolutely in full sacred support of you without any exception. And when you feel this way, then you'll start feeling like, wow, I too am the Son of God. I too. And you begin to remember your true status. Okay, which of course Jesus is fully aware of his true status. But we are still have some doubts about it because we've been preparing to have our status be within the kingdom of time, which is not the same status as we truly have at all. We're preparing to lose our status, essentially. We've been simulating the loss of our status for so long that we've got some doubts about it. And how can we resolve these doubts other than to feel this absolute sacred support? So to me, it does seem like Jesus is still in full support of the Trinity teaching. Okay, he's not backing off from that one in whatsoever. And that if you want to be part of his, you know, what he's doing, I feel that you do need to accept this Trinity teaching. This is what he seemed to indicate to me. And I was a little bit resistant to it. I was thinking, well, what about the other configurations, you know? And he says, no, just three is where it's, and he's very gentle about it. He says, three is all you need. You don't need any more than that, but no less than that either. No less than that either. And I go along with that. Absolutely, I go along with that. I'm seeing the wisdom of that, because we do need this reassurance that we're the authors of this simulation of time and not God. That is super, super, super important. And the Holy Spirit is that which gives us this reassurance. And it's actually a creation of God, knowing that this reassurance needed to be given. Because without that, we're going to deny authorship of this and insist that God is the one, and therefore God must believe that the time is going to start. Otherwise, would not have created the simulation for us. And if time wasn't going to start, then this is just some absolutely viciously cruel hoax on the part of God. There's no other way to look at it. There's no other way to look at it, actually. And, you know, Buddhism and Hinduism basically try to get around it by saying nobody knows why this arose. This is their standard. Even the Advaita teachers, they say that. Says, well, why did all these adventitious thoughts, why, you know, we don't know where it came from. We just don't know. Really? I've always seen that as a great weakness of those traditions. I said, really? We don't know where any of this simulation came from? It just appeared out of nothing for no reason whatsoever? Really? That's nonsense. It's unbelievable nonsense. But for some reason, they felt that ignoring this issue, it was important. Maybe the idea of the Trinity was just too difficult for people of that time to understand, just too difficult. And so they said, why even bring it up? Because they're not going to understand it. So they focused on self-discipline and practice, which is great. But I feel this new dispensation now, you will definitely need to focus on the Trinity. You will definitely need to focus. Christianity, I feel, is a new dispensation which is designed to streamline the path of salvation for everyone. It's designed to streamline it and make it a lot easier. You ask the Buddhist and Hindus, what about Maya? You know, I mean, what is giving rise to Maya? Say, you know, well, it's just there. We don't know. It just happened to arise. It just happens to be there. Okay, so there's something outside of my mind, outside of God. Why did my mind conjure all this up in the first place? Well, desire. Well, why did I have desire? You know, see, you ask these, you know, questions, inconvenient questions. Well, we don't know why. We don't know why Maya started. We just don't know why. But we just need to escape it. Well, wouldn't it be good to know why it arose in order to escape it? Wouldn't that be very helpful to know that? So don't be afraid of the Trinity teaching. It is the key. It is the key to this smooth, easy liberation. Don't need all that other nonsense. That stuff, the other teachings lead to a lot of entanglement in psychic powers, in all sorts of demi realms and the dream. It leads to trying to control the dream. The temptation is very strong there. It can lead to many, many problems. But if you have the teaching of the Trinity and you get that right, this really protects you from all that nonsense. So it helps avoid a massive amount of delay. It is possible in those other ways, because the intention is pure, to ultimately free yourself. It is absolutely as possible, because it's been done, okay? I'd be a fool to say it hasn't been done. Absolutely, it's been done. But the potential for delay is massive in those other approaches. And you need a very disciplined culture to try and avoid that. As we have seen, that doesn't last. Okay, so you really need a path that is much easier, much simpler, much clearer, much more streamlined, much less temptation. So you can get it done. You can get it done. And the teaching of the Trinity makes this possible. Absolutely makes it possible. When you get clear about this, and you take full ownership of this simulation, which is what it is, it's a dream. You take full ownership of causing this. and don't give God one bit of responsibility for causing this dream whatsoever. Absolutely not. God had nothing to do with this simulation. God is completely innocent of this. Completely innocent. Played no role whatsoever in it. Then by taking full ownership of it, that is the key to then realizing you have complete authority to give it a different purpose. And you don't have to suddenly wake up from this dream. You don't have to do it that way. That way is incredibly difficult and frightening. You can give this dream a different purpose. This is the easy, gentle way. The other ways are tremendously difficult. The ways of mind discipline, all the stuff, the other paths, tremendously difficult. But the way of taking ownership of this dream of simulation and realizing you can simply give it a different purpose, like that. And it absolutely has to obey you. And it absolutely will. And it'll be absolutely thrilled with this new purpose. The universe will be absolutely thrilled, full of gratitude towards you, radiating gratitude, shining with joy, happiness, joy, bliss, and gratitude towards you, the author of the dream, who has dropped the demand that it try to prepare you for time, and now it's able to prepare you for reality. What joy, what joy, what joy the light has. You know, this whole dream is, of course, uses the light to simulate false light, electromagnetism. So instead of struggling with electromagnetism and energy and trying to move all this energy through the body and all this esoteric stuff, you don't need any of that. You don't need any of that. Teaching of the Trinity helps bypass all of that stuff. You can change the purpose of your universe this instant, and it will absolutely obey. You don't need to delay at all. There's no need for any delay, because there's no dynamic of God working in this simulation whatsoever. So what do you need to wait for? We don't need to wait for, well, God's doing something here. There's, you know, I gotta wait until God's work is done, or, you know, all right. There's no work of God being done in this simulation for time. It's all our own play. It's all our own fantasy. And so we can change the purpose. We can't change the purpose of God, but we can certainly change the purpose of a dream that we dreamed up. Absolutely we can. So I had this meeting with Jesus, and people might be skeptical about it, but you can see why this meeting took place, because I'm very simpatico with what his teaching is, and what his perspective is. I'm willing to accept it and say, yeah, I see what you're getting at. This is ultimately how to save so much delay for everyone, ultimately. Tremendously helpful. So, of course, he's going to allow a meeting between someone who's very simpatico with what his mission is. You know, not wanting to offend any other traditions at all. Which, again, you can make it that way too. But the overall mission of Jesus is to save all this delay, massive delay, which to minimize how long we flounder in hell, to minimize how long we flounder in hell, everyone, all spirit, to minimize it. And in order to minimize it, it needs to be streamlined. And this teaching of the Trinity needs to take root, okay? Needs to take root. Profoundly helpful to minimize how long we keep floundering around in hell. So in if Jesus has a place he's prepared, he does indicate that he has a quote-unquote dwelling place. I was invited to go there. He invited me. The teaching of the Trinity is what's going to be emphasized. Absolutely. Will absolutely be emphasized there. Jesus absolutely emphasizes the Holy Spirit. No question about it. He absolutely emphasizes that the Son is not greater than the Father. The Father is greater than the Son. He absolutely emphasizes the God, the prime creator, God the Father is greater than God the Son, in that God the prime creator created God the Son, but God the Son did not create God the prime creator. Okay, and that the Holy Spirit is a creation of God the prime creator to help God the Son with this one issue that we have of trying to change reality, and to assure us that this simulation we have is all our own doing and not God's. This is super important. So if you teach the Trinity from the very beginning of any of a mission, this is the fundamental teaching you give from the very beginning, then ultimately this helps your path be much quicker and smoother, and you reach the goal of changing the purpose of the simulation. Okay. And you don't have to worry about, well, how do I awaken from this dream directly? You say you do it indirectly by changing the purpose of the dream. And it makes it way easier this way. Way easier. That's why you have these Advaita teachers, let's be honest. And they say, well, I've only met like one other enlightened, non-dual enlightened being in my entire life. That's like what Punjaji said, that one or two, maybe only two Advaitins. And you see these teachers, and you know, no one gets hardly anyone gets enlightened by going to see them. What is that? Well, it means it's extremely difficult. The so-called direct way of just suddenly awakening from the dream. Jesus says it's extremely rare that that happens. Extremely rare. Extremely difficult. Extremely rare. And therefore, to hold that up as the ideal is to really foster an enormous amount of delay. Unnecessary delay. The way is to give a different purpose to the dream that we're dreaming. That's the way. We can do that right now. It's easy. And of course, those others will say, well, you didn't awaken from the dream. What is this? I say, well, you check back a little later, okay, and you will find that I am absolutely awakened from the dream, and I did it smoothly and very quickly, right? So all those who criticize this, well, let them first be awake entirely from the dream and then see what they have to say. You know, being a fanboy of non-dual teaching is not going to get the job done. Or a fangirl, fanboy, fangirl of non-dual teaching, it's not going to get the job done. Yeah, what I've been seeing my whole life is we just flounder. Sure, we can talk a good game, but we're still floundering. The real goal, still, we don't even understand it. We're still floundering. Yeah, we just can regurgitate and parrot all this non-dual talk. The actual momentum, you know, it's not there. It's not there. Now with these ebooks, people can write five books a year, you know, and regurgitate all this non-dual teaching. You know. You know, ah, some ancient teaching. I found some ancient non-dual teaching. Let me regurgitate that for you. And the fanboys and girls say, oh yeah, this is great, this is wonderful, you know, this is wonderful. And they're still scratching their heads saying, yeah, And and this is what's happened. I'm just observing the last 60 years on this planet. Where's all the enlightened beings? They're not here. Where are they? Point them out to me, really. The true ones, okay? No, we just have a bunch of people who can regurgitate non-dual teachings here. And then, you know, go get high and have fun with their partner and basically, yeah. Go to retreats occasionally and get another hit of non-dual rhetoric. Spiritual rhetoric, New Age rhetoric. We have a bunch of people who can regurgitate a whole bunch of New Age rhetoric is what we have. But where are the enlightened beings? They seem to have vanished. And again, in this age of ebooks, we can just inundate it by, you know, so many books. We think, oh my God, how can I read all these books? I need a bigger library. No, we don't need any library at all. I have, you know, a couple books, that's it. I have three books. A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, and the Vajra Heart, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart by Longchenpa, who's an expert in practice. Longchenpa is an expert, so that's helpful. Buddhism is helpful because they're experts in practice. So there are aspects of that are quite helpful, and Longchenpa, being someone who is truly liberated, certainly understands the whole picture. The emphasis is on practice, and so this helps. This helps. Jesus also tells us we must practice, but he also provides the full explanation of the Trinity, which is extremely helpful going forward. He says his teachings were for the teachers of God, meaning there will be teachers of God going forward, whether on this planet or wherever. And he's preparing those teachers of God to teach the Trinity, absolutely. So even though I'm very aware of Buddhist teachings, Hindu teachings, and even Islam, teachings of Islam and other traditions, when I ultimately teach, I absolutely will emphasize the Trinity. Absolutely I will. There's no way around that. It's because this is what ultimately saves so much floundering in hell for so many. So much. So even though I've been greatly helped out by Longchenpa, helping in my practice and my assertions and all this, I will absolutely emphasize the Trinity going forward, even though that is not really a part of his teachings. The practical aspects of practicing, really you're practicing to change the purpose of your dream is what you're really practicing for. But keep in mind, what you experienced then is still a dream. It's still a dream. It absolutely still is a dream. But you shouldn't take that in a negative way. You should take it in a positive way, because this provides us, it solves the continuity fear for us. I say, wonderful, now I have a dream of total support for I am what I am, total support of identity, spiritual identity, complete support with no trace of non-support. Whether that support's for a body, a spirit, whatever, it's still pure support, pure loving, grateful, blissful support for whatever it is I am. But I can feel the support, and so therefore I must be worthy of this support. Therefore, what is it that's truly worthy of such support? And you say, well, it can't be time at all, can it? And so then you automatically, easily, can accept then ultimately the final resolution into pure knowing. Okay. Easy. Easy. Automatic. We need only feel the support, like Ramana Maharshi said, only abide in the self, which really is this full support, this feeling is full support, even though it's still a dream. And Jesus tells us, if you were not still experiencing a simulation, you couldn't even appear here, keep your appearance here at all. So if those who have an appearance in this world, they are experiencing this dream of pure support and abiding in that. And telling us you can do this too. Okay. So don't attack the dream. Give it a different purpose. This is what Jesus tells us. Don't attack the dream. Give it a different purpose. And we say, well, how can I do that? I mean, what do you mean? This universe is, these are the laws of God, the dynamic. No, they're not. No, they're not. There's not one speck of this universe that reflects the laws of God. You know, this universe reflects what we believe are going to be the laws of time. This universe reflects what we believe is going to be the laws of time. That's what it reflects. I should have also mentioned Judaism as a great tradition also, when I talked about the other traditions, and again, being strictly monotheistic and not really teaching the Trinity, although some of the esoteric traditions of Judaism may teach the Trinity in some way, it's a little bit nebulous there. It's not out in the open, let's put it that way. Whereas Christianity is completely out in the open. Look, folks, this is what we stand for. We stand for the Trinity, plain and simple. Not backing off of that. This is the fundamental root foundation of our teaching is the Trinity. That's it. Because this is what ultimately smooths everything out and makes it simple and easy, which is we deserve that. Right? We're still trying to make it difficult because we're still thinking we need some expertise in time, that we're going to bring that expertise in time back into reality with us just to be safe, you know, as if that will make us superior in reality. Like, yeah, I know how to function in reality, but I also know how to function in time too. And I'm superior than you. It's still bringing arrogance back into reality, trying to bring arrogance back into reality. That never works. It doesn't work. That will never work. So, it's very helpful to start out with the Trinity and get used to that. And then keep on refining that, refining it, refining it. And then when you're taught this, this whole universe doesn't reflect the laws of God at all, then it's not a problem. You say, oh yeah, it's not a problem. Holy Spirit has told me this. See, you have the foundation then to change the purpose of the dream. You have the foundation. The Trinity is the foundation upon what this then you do. No problem. For me, I don't have any problem at all with this. So, yeah, of course. What's the big deal? And see? So it provides this foundation upon which you're able to then make this all-important, vastly helpful. Oh, let me just change the purpose of the dream. I have complete authority to do that. That doesn't interfere with any of the laws of God at all. So there's no guilt, there's no sin, there's no fear, there's no resistance. Just say it. I say it and it is so. Like that. And there's no esoteric secrets of energy manipulation in order to make this happen. It's not like you need to manipulate the dream. You're the absolute authority of this dream. Why do you need to manipulate it? That's ridiculous. Why do you need some secret? That's ridiculous. Why do you need to figure something out? That's ridiculous. Why do you need to be under the spell of this dream at all and claim you need to do something or learn something? That's ridiculous. What do you need to learn? You're about this dream, in this dream, you're complete sovereign over it. You're the dreamer of the dream. What do you need to learn about? What do you need to learn in the dream? What is it you need to learn about the cosmos in order to give it a different purpose? Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. Now, of course, the time worshippers, they don't like these other traditions either. let's be clear about that. Because, you're right. But they really hate Christianity and the Trinity teaching. And so what they'll do is they'll try to get you into these other traditions. And they say, well, that's much more hip. You know, like, you know, the chicks are more hip there. You know, they're more hip to you. They'll warm up to you more. But they really won't warm up to you when you this Trinity teaching, you know. So they try to attract you, say, oh yeah, I'm into this too, you know, I'm little miss fangirl of this other traditions, and wow, when you start talking that rhetoric, you know, like, hey, I got some body thoughts towards you, amazing, you know. When you start talking about the Trinity, oh my God, I don't have any body thoughts towards you at all, you know. Oh, don't, stay away from me. And I say, oh, well, thank you very much. So there's not any fangirls of the Trinity really at all, are there? Fanboys or fangirls of that at all. So that's why we're tempted, you know, to go into these other traditions. We're tempted to go into them because they seem, you know, there's more fangirlism in that. Trying to at least get you, the first step is get you away from the Trinity, and then they'll work on getting you away from these other traditions too. They don't want you in those either. They want you fully into full-time body thoughts and reflecting back to them, like, oh my gosh, my thought of your body is so incredibly wonderful, you know, I'm completely addicted to it, you know, that's what they want you. And so they want to feel that you're relating to them entirely through body thoughts, that their identity is just a body. This is how they're trying to prepare for time. So these fangirls, they don't like the Trinity at all. It's like a kryptonite to them. Ah! It's like, wow, stay away from that. And they very intensely try to lobby you with trying to attractive body thoughts to try and get you away from the Trinity teaching. Absolutely, they do. And having been through all that, I can tell you it's no fun at all. It's very, very bad. Very undesirable. Very much so. And so this is why right now this is very difficult to get any focus on this teaching for anybody, because they're saying, well, wait a minute, if I go into this Trinity teaching, the fangirls will completely desert me, or the fanboys. If you're a woman, the fanboys will desert you, okay? They will. They won't be saying, oh, little Miss Shakti, you're so wonderful, I have all these body thoughts for you, so great, you know. No, they'll say, oh, what? You're listening to Jesus and the Trinity? Oh, you know, if you're a woman, they'll say, oh, no more, all the fanboys will desert you. All the fangirls too will desert you. And if you're a guy, all the fanboys and fanboys will say, whoa, you know, that's too much religion for me. That's too fundamental. Ah, wow, I don't want that. And they'll desert you. Absolutely, that's true. And so right now, there's so much desertion of this teaching. There's so much desertion of it taking place. that were wondering, oh my God, you know, I won't have any fanboy or fangirl support whatsoever. This is, you know, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? Well, then realize the support for you will come from the entire universe, from every pebble, from every rock, from every stream, from every leaf, from every speck of dust. There's nothing in the universe in terms of the nature of the universe that won't be totally giving you total sacred support, reassuring you that there's no way you can be without perfect support. You're absolutely supported. The whole universe is in total support of you. That's what you'll experience. That's where your support will come. It won't come from the fanboys or the fangirls. Absolutely not. You know, yeah, as they, you know, they can spout all this non-dual religious New Age rhetoric. All the while they're saying, how do you like my fangirlism? You know, isn't this cool? You know, don't you have some body? What's your body thought about that? You know, this is how it is in the world, isn't it? I'm just, you know, showing up a mirror and you realize, yeah, this is so. This is what's going on right now. Absolutely it is. They say, well, of course you can have both. You can have this non-dual rhetoric and the body thoughts too. What's wrong with that? Loosen up. Come on. Lighten up. Don't be so fundamental. What's the matter with you? You some kind of fanatic or something? You can be even superior to reality. You know how to function both in reality and time. You know, what's wrong with that? You know, that's better. This is what you're getting. And see here, you know, you don't see the fanboys and the fangirls showing up here, right? So much, hardly, right? I mean, you get people here that are like seriously considering this. You don't have this massive outpouring of fangirls and fanboys, blah, blah, blah. Because that's not what we're teaching here. That's not where it's at. We're emphasizing that what really works fast and smooth and easy for you, the safe way, the way of emphasizing the Trinity, absolutely, absolutely emphasizing the Trinity, which is emphasizing our complete sovereign responsibility for this dream of simulation, this simulation, without a speck of God's involvement in it whatsoever. Therefore, to change the purpose of it is easy for us. It's not breaking any laws of God, is it? We don't have to make a deal with God. We don't have to defeat God in any way to change the purpose of this dream. We don't have to be special at all. We don't have to get some special covenant or dispensation for God saying, God, like, God, I do this for you. Can you then change the dream for me? You know, we don't have to be in any deal making whatsoever with God. So it's truly a blessing and an honor to be involved with this teaching of the Trinity, what Jesus' mission is. It's a blessing and honor because you're really saving others a massive amount of delay and floundering in hell. You're saving a massive amount of floundering in hell because this teaching, this clarity, will ultimately trickle down and begin to permeate them. And they realize they don't have to make any deals or covenants with God. None whatsoever. None whatsoever. They don't have to be special. They don't have to gain some sort of status in the dream to change the purpose of the dream. You don't have to attain any status at all in the dream to change the dream. I don't have any status. I don't have any status at all here. As far as the world, as far as the dream is concerned, I'm like on the bottom. Okay? Like someone like is devoid of status, you know. Only value they can give me. Say, wow, this guy has no value at all for the dream. Well, go pick up garbage then. You know, that's what I do. Pick up garbage. That's what the status this dream time gives me is a garbage picker. Pick up garbage. You know, basically, that's it. I don't need any status to change the purpose of the dream. I'm sovereign over the dream. Complete sovereign over it. Entirely. I'm sovereign over the entire universe. Absolutely. And so are you. And so are you. Again, in perception, each one has a different universe, actually. So you're totally sovereign over your universe, completely sovereign over your universe, without needing to prove that sovereignty to the universe in any way whatsoever. You don't need to do anything to prove your sovereignty. You don't need to do anything to attain the status of sovereign. You're inherently the sovereign over your universe. You always have been. You don't need to do anything to prove it to the universe. You don't need to prove anything to the universe. All right? You do not, or to anyone else in their universe. You absolutely do not have to do any proving whatsoever. You don't need to prove anything. You don't need to attain any status whatsoever. You are this instant, without doing anything, totally sovereign over your own universe, and you absolutely can change the purpose of it right this instant, and it will absolutely change for you and reassure you that you have total sacred support for your being. Not a trace of non-support. Not one trace of non-support. Nothing can happen to you. You absolutely have total sacred support. These are the teachings of Jesus. These are the teachings of Jesus. And maybe a light's going on and saying, wow, I'm starting to get this. You know, this is way easier. This is way better. This is super helpful. Wow, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to attain any status. You know, wow. There's nothing I need to do in order to change the purpose of my dream. I'm already, even though I'm pretending to be this body with all these troubles, this is, again, just part of the simulation of the dream. I'm really spirit. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am the sovereign of this dream. God does not dream this dream. I am. Spirit is. So, again, no, I don't need to make any deals with God. I don't need to get on the good side of God. I don't need to try and say I'm special with God. I don't need to have God have mercy on me. Say, God, I'm suffering so bad here. You know, look at me. I'm sick. And won't you please make a special dispensation for me and, you know, change the dream for me because I'm so, you know, terribly wiped out here, God. You know, I don't need to do that either. I don't need to do that either. I don't need to there's nothing I need to do with this dream in order to have the power to change it. There's nothing that needs to happen in this dream in order for me to have the power to give it a different purpose. Nothing whatsoever. It makes no difference what happens in this dream. I still have absolute sovereign authority over it. These are the teachings of Jesus. And the more you hear this, the more you accept this, the more you begin to realize, wow, this is true. And then the more you realize, wow, this just saves me from all floundering, doesn't it? All floundering in hell. I don't need to flounder in hell for one moment to have sovereignty over this simulated dream, this dream simulation. And I don't need any non-floundering status in this dream of simulation in order to have sovereignty over it either, right? So why am I wasting time? What am I waiting for? What am I waiting for? Waiting is useless. It doesn't accomplish anything. Of course, and the shock of this realization requires patience, full stop in the wow, so that we don't retreat into waiting as a basic premise, okay? So we use waiting as a pragmatic, conscious technique, full stop in the wow, so we don't lapse back into waiting as a basic premise, as a basic necessity, as necessity. We realize there's no necessity to it, and this temporarily shocks us. And so we say, okay, we will continue to wait a little longer, but in the context of realizing there's no necessity whatsoever to waiting. We're doing it just because of a continuity issue. That's the only reason why we're doing it. And then that we're fine with that, you see? We're fine with that. We can full stop in the wow. How are we doing here? Doing well, as usual. You see, we try all sorts of things to try to get this dream changed, thinking that we can't change it ourselves, that something else has to change it, whether it's God or just somehow just changes on its own, or there's some cycle to all this. There's all a plan where all will change if we just wait in long enough, and or if we just do the right thing, if we do the right rituals, it will change. Do the right magic, it will change. All this kind of stuff. We don't need to do any of that. None of that's effective. None of it's effective. It might give us little glimpses of, because of our intention. Our intention is right. We do want to change it, but it will never result in this abidance, this continual feeling of absolute sacred support for I am what I am, without a trace of non-support. It will not result in that. And ultimately, this is what we need in order to accept what we truly are. Just perfectly free, perfectly free spirit. So if you praise what I'm saying in this message, then you're also praising Jesus, because this is the message of Jesus also. This is his emphasis, okay? This emphasis. And you think, wow, we certainly have a lot of strange idols we've made of Jesus in the past, right? Absolutely, we've made a lot of strange idols. Thinking that we need to do it both. We need to be both experts in time and reality, you know. So we come up with a very strange idol of Jesus that he's supporting both of this, you know. He's saying, oh yeah, you got to be able to good at both. It's not true. And Jesus never taught that. That was never his intention, never his purpose, but he understands that these strange idols will be made, idols of compromise will be made, until we finally settle into the real true clarity about the Trinity and recognize our sovereignty over this dream. Until we settle into that, we'll keep making sort of strange idols of Jesus, thinking that he's teaching this compromise message. And we can have a treaty, a compromise, both. We can have both. That's the goddess teaching. That's not Jesus' teaching. And so only when you settle in to the clarity of the Trinity and the clarity of your sovereignty over this dream, etc., then you can actually meet with Jesus. You actually meet with Jesus, and you're not looking for some strange idol. You're not saying, wait a minute, Jesus, you don't seem like this, what I thought you were supposed to be. I thought you were this strange idol teaching both, and you're not teaching both. You're only teaching this one. So are you really Jesus? I'm not sure. I mean, I thought you were this way. You know, I thought you were this idol. But when you set down these strange idols of Jesus, then you can experience Jesus just as he is. Just as he is. It's very simple, very clear, very basic, very calm. Not confused. Not some strange idol teaching some, you know, bizarre compromise between truth and lies. Not at all. Not teaching that God is in charge of this dream and you need to do all these ritual sacrifices in order to appease God, and hopefully, you know, God will help give you some support in this dream. Saying, God, I just don't have any support in this dream. Can you give me a little bit, you know? If I just sacrifice these calves for you, will you give me a little bit of support? That is not Jesus. Jesus is not teaching that at all. Never has. We're looking for crumbs of help. Help, help, help. God, give me a crumb of support. My God, why are you torturing me this way in this horrible existence, you know, that you supposedly created for me? Why did you make me a body, God? Why did you make me suffer, God? Blah, blah, blah. And Jesus is not teaching that at all. Never, never taught that. We made an idol of Jesus and then we put stuffed words into this idol's mouth, so the idol regurgitates it, and we think, oh, this is what Jesus is teaching. Oh, meanwhile, Jesus just shaking his head said, no, that's not what I'm teaching at all. We have to laugh at it, right? We've been there, we've done it, we got to own it. You know, we've gone through the silliness of own it. That's okay. I mean, laugh at it. We understand. We can forgive ourselves. Oh, okay. I was trying to combine both truth and lies because I was so so into this thinking my identity would be based on time that I felt I had to become sophisticated in functioning in time. And so I felt I had to join the two, you know, and so I had to make an idol out of Jesus and stuff teachings into his mouth. You know, this is what I did. Okay. Own it, own it, own it. Say, okay, that's what I did. Fine. And Jesus is not judging us for that. No. He's just saying, you know, come to the real true teaching, come to the true teaching. Everything will be fine once you get there. Don't worry. Forgive yourself, forgive yourself, forgive yourself, forgive yourself, forgive yourself. As your Father forgives you, right? Yeah. God has no issue with us whatsoever. Nothing to forgive. You know, but God says, look, Holy Spirit tells us, reassures us, which is this reassurance of the Holy Spirit really is forgiveness. When we realize that we're the authors of this dream, oh, and then we're forgiving ourselves, like, wow, okay, all this foolishness I've engaged in, I forgive myself for that. We have to, right? If we take it seriously, trying to believe that God was the author of this, or trying to combine partially and partially the author, and we're partially the author, and we're being foolish, we're making idols. We have to forgive that in order to accept sovereignty over our dream. We have to forgive ourselves and say, oh, okay, I was mistaken, that's all. And now I've corrected the mistake, which is what we have to do. Mistakes, what are they for? Well, we got to correct them. You know, we make a mistake, we just correct it. We don't beat ourselves up over it. We just say, wow, okay, this isn't right, so what is right? So is Jesus going to be this idol, a New Age hippie idol? No. Is Jesus going to be this swinging rabbi? You know, no. That's an idol. So we New Age is making all these idols, you know, and so that, yeah, that just listen to these idols and they will regurgitate to you, and you'll have the answer from them. Is Jesus going to be that, as one of those idols? No, just like he's never been any of these idols. He's clear about his teaching. He's not going to get confused. He's not going to teach a mixed message. He's not going to teach compromise between truth and lies. Absolutely not. You'll never get that out of Jesus. So if you really want to be spiritually hip, you got to hang out with truth. You can't hang out with a mixed message. You cannot hang out with a mixed message. You know, you might have a bunch of fan chicks, you know, telling you how great you are. A bunch of fangirls, or a bunch of fanboys, or both, you know, telling you how great you are. How hip you are, you know, but you won't be hanging out with Jesus, that's for sure. You won't be hanging out with truth, that's for sure. You won't be experiencing an entire universe of absolute love and support and gratitude and bliss towards you without any iota of non-support every single instant, permanent disappointment. You won't be experiencing that. You're going to be floundering in hell, to tell you the truth. Floundering in hell. Floundering in hell. And calling this floundering some sort of spiritual dance, you know, making a dance out of it. Say, hey, let's do the flounder dance. Oh yeah, let's say that this is like, God loves the flounder dance, and if we do it right, then God will bless us. So let's all do the flounder dance. You know, like the Rocky Horror Show, or let's all do the time warp again, or something. What they say, you know, let's all keep doing the time warp. Come on, let's do the flounder dance again. Let's keep doing the flounder dance, and we'll wear all these wonderful costumes, you know, and we'll make it into this big religion, the flounder dance. There is a new network connection. Blah blah blah, or whatever. Yeah, so. You know, are you going to have fun doing the flounder dance in hell? It's not going to be that much fun, is it? Meanwhile, those who have followed the real teaching, you know, and got the truth, the teaching of truth, and accepted it, corrected their mistakes, they're abiding in this, you know, universe of glory, glorious love, support, gratitude, and bliss, and they're abiding in that, and then they're even going beyond that to that which cannot be even spoken about. The glory is beyond our anything we can imagine, and yet you're still doing the flounder dance in hell, you know, saying, "I'm cool, I'm hip." The fangirls, the fanboys, they think I'm kind of cool. Maybe, of course, the next moment they say, "Maybe you're not as cool as I thought you were. Wait, I thought you were like so totally cool. Wow, how hip! You're so hip." And now, right now, I'm like feeling like, well, maybe you're not as hip as I thought you were, and maybe I see someone else over there that's even hipper. Oh, I'm taking my fangirl, fanboyness over there now. Yeah, right? And you say, no, don't leave. Look at this. I got a new move in the flounder dance here. And they say, oh. Yeah, you are hip, but great. I was sort of wondering about it, but now I see it. I kind of like this. You threw a little variation. Oh, wow, it's really hip. Maybe I can get with that too. Meanwhile, we're doing the flounder dance in hell, and we're, you know, wow, what a party we're having here. This is great. And the next morning, suddenly the fangirls are gone. The fanboys are gone. They see someone else who's even a more swinging rabbi, you know, hey, I'm a really swinging Buddhist rabbi, whatever, you know, and we'll get down here, let's get down, let's party, a lot of sex, drugs, and rock and roll here, and I'll pump a whole bunch of hip new age terminology at you, and wow, this is like a great best of both worlds, you know, let's party. And there go the fangirls and boys there. And they say, well, what shall we call you? Idol? You know, well, just call me God, or you can call me the great God, or the greatest of all gods, or you can call me this, or, you know, you can call me... And I say, okay. And they start saying, hey, this isn't that much fun. And then the swinging rabbi, Buddhist, whatever, says, guess what, everybody, all fanboys and fangirls? Today, I have a new name, and it's even greater than the name before, and I'm finally allowing you to call me this. And they say, oh, that's so hip, that's so cool, I get to call you this? Yes, I'm blah, 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 blah now. And they say, oh, wow, we didn't realize we're hanging out with such a cool swinging new age guru. Our faith in your hipness is now restored, because you have this hyphenated name now. Oh, wow. You're not only God, you're now the great God, and now you're the great swinging God, and now you're the great hip new age God, and there are no other gods, and blah, 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 blah. Oh, wow. Our fanboy, fangirlism has been fully restored now. Let's get in the groove with this. Let's party. Let's dance. The flounder dance. Come on. And then a little later, it's like, wow. This just isn't it, you know. Wow, I just feel like, you know. And then the new age guru says, "Hey, everybody, guess what? I'm going to give you the newest update, and I have a new name. I have a new name, and it's only because you've been so dedicated to me that I'm able to share the secret name with you. I wouldn't share it with anybody else, but your incredible fanboyness and fangirlness is so awesome that it's." Compelled me to release this new name to you, and now I am to be called this, da da da, da 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 da, you know. And they say, oh wow, we're special. Just absolutely, you're special. Your specialness has compelled me to release this new name to you and reveal who I really am to you, and I really am totally hip, you know. And they say, oh wow, we're so special, we're so important, this is it. Oh gosh. Let's dance. This is fabulous. And then later on, it doesn't feel so fabulous anymore. They say, I just don't feel the full support from the universe. I just don't feel I'm completely supported by it. And I want to feel supported, but I'm just not quite getting the buzz of support right now. And, you know, and I think I might want to leave. And then the New Age guru says, ah, this is all just a test. I just tested you. And now I have the final name to reveal to you. And they say, okay, the other names, yeah, they were great, but you weren't ready for the final name. But now I have the final name, and you will realize the final, what I really am, you know, the fullness of what I really am, and the endless hipness of what I, and the endless support I have for you. And I say, oh my gosh, okay, I was almost ready to leave, and now you have this for me. Oh, great. I'm so blessed. This is wonderful. I get to stay a fangirl, fanboy forever. We get to be hip forever in time. Isn't this wonderful? What's the new name? Yeah. Okay. Oh, wow. I'm so far now. I finally got it. That's it. The full transmission. I finally got the full transmission. Yes. Now I'm so special. Wow. Now I feel like I'm completely understand time, and I'm completely know how to function that, and I completely understand the sacred, and I'm both, and I'm one, I'm both this and everything. Wow, you know, yeah. Now I'm feeling it. And the guru says, yes, but of course, you must be permanently loyal to me now that I've revealed the support that I have now for you. You must never leave me. You can never leave me. We have a covenant, you see. Oh my gosh, I don't want to leave you. Why would I want to leave you, great New Age swinging guru? Of course we have this covenant. How could it be other? I'm an eternal fangirl, fanboy to you. Absolutely. You know, how could you ever doubt that? I'm hurt you could ever doubt that I could not be in this. I'm in an intrinsic covenant with you. I can never leave you. And the guru's sitting there saying, yeah, I don't. For some reason, I don't trust them. I want to trust them, but I don't. I think they wanted to leave me before, and how can I trust they won't leave me again? I got to keep thinking of. I got to think of one more name here. But I already told them this was the ultimate name. You know, maybe I need to just like disappear or something. I don't know. What can I do? What can I do? I'm running out of names here. The well is dry. Holy cow. I think I've used all my names up. I need to make a quick exit. Let me make a quick exit. Poof, gone. I don't want them to get mad at me, you know. I don't want them to leave me. That'll blow my mind. That's terrible. I can't handle that. I can't handle that. So I'm just going to depart the scene then very quickly. Make a quick French exit. Gone. This is exactly what happens, isn't it? That's exactly what's happened, has happened, will happen, is happening in this flounder dance in hell. Learn the Trinity. Learn the Trinity. Get clear about the Trinity, and you will not be susceptible to this nonsense. The name game. You won't be susceptible. You won't be so susceptible to the name game. Oh, man. And if you've been involved in that, and we all have to some degree, you know, laugh at it, laugh at it, laugh at it. That clears it out of you. It clears it out of you. Don't be all angry and upset. Laugh at it, laugh at it, laugh at it. Make a joke. It was a ridiculous flounder dance we were all doing. Flip-flop flounder dance in hell, you know, we don't have to be good at that. We don't need to be good at that. We didn't no need to get our support from God in the dreams of this of God figure. I need to get support from you. No, we are sovereigns of our own dream. We are the God of our own dream. We are the God of our own dream. Okay, so don't listen to somebody comes and tells you, I am God over you and I'm the greatest and like they're gods over your dream. No, they're not. You are God over your own dream. Total sovereign over it. Total sovereign. So you and you alone have the power and authority to change the purpose of your dream. No guru has the power to change your dream like that. Look out for those gurus who say they have the power to change your dream for you. They do not. They do not. You have the power. The real teachers will teach you, you have the power. Only you have the power. It's your dream. You have complete soul authority over your dream to change its purpose. Absolutely. And if, of course, if you're trying to get ready for time, you'll be pretending that you don't have authority of this dream. Because in time, you don't have any authority. It's time that has the authority over you. Since it's a simulation for how to function in time, you will feel that you don't have authority over it. So you'll run to some guru and say, hey, guru, can you please give me a little bit of support and make me feel better and bless my life and this kind of stuff. And you become dependent on that nonsense. The blessings that a teacher can give you is clarity about the whole situation and gradually help you realize you are the sovereign over your own dream. You have sole authority over your own dream. You have the authority to change the purpose of your dream. But as long as you are still trying to prepare for time and believing in that, you won't feel that way. You won't feel that way. You feel you don't have the authority. Because obviously, authority to change the purpose of your dream means you're really spirit. And you're trying to prepare for time, you're trying to prepare for that you're not spirit anymore. And you're going to be controlled by something, you know, greater than you, time. Under the authority of time. That then therefore you need to have whatever you experience has to go through time, the authority of time, in order for you to experience it. So you won't feel that you have absolute authority over anything of your experiencing. So you believe you're in a situation of circumstances and situations. There's a circumstance, the situation, it's happening to me. All this stuff's happening to me, and I have to learn how to get blessed circumstances and situations that'll bless me somehow. How do I do that? You know, I don't have the authority to do that. I gotta go to this idol to get power from this idol, worship this idol, give gifts to the idol, make sacrifices to the idol, swear eternal covenants to the idol, you know, get some secret mantra from the idol, get some secret magic from the idol in order to somehow get these circumstances to be better for me, you know. This is what you'll be trapped in. This is the flounder dance in hell. So there is this difficulty in accepting that you have sovereignty over your dream. Because then you say, well, then I can't really get prepared for time, can I? Well, that's right. You don't need to, because there's no such thing as time. Never will be a kingdom of time. So you certainly don't need to learn how to manipulate circumstances and situations. You don't need to be manipulative. Okay? This is what so many are doing. They're learning to be very manipulative. This is not the way. This is not the way. These New Age gurus are just the ones who are, you know, more adept at manipulation. A lot of them. Okay, a lot of them. Very adept at manipulation. Very adept at it. And so since you want to think you need to become very adept at manipulation, they seem to be the answer for you. So, oh yeah, wow, this is what I need. I need to become a genius at manipulating circumstances and people and stuff and everything and getting them to worship me and support me and all this kind of stuff. I need to be a genius at that. So here's someone who's going to help me do that. You don't need to know how to manipulate anything. You're the sovereign over this dream simulation. Total sovereign over it. You can literally change the entire purpose of the whole dream all at once. The entire universe, you can change the purpose of it all just with one choice like that. No manipulation. Not a manipulation, just an assertion. Just a choice. You don't need to be any skills of manipulation whatsoever. The entire universe has no choice but to align with the new purpose that you gave it. Instant alignment. Has no choice whatsoever. You don't have to play any games. You don't have to coerce it. You don't have to manipulate the universe in any way whatsoever. It will absolutely change for you instantaneously with no resistance whatsoever. And your belief that there's resistance there is only your belief in time. That's all there is. That you still need to prepare for time. That's it. How are we doing here? Trucking along, trucking along. It gets better as it goes along, right? These tapings get better. They get more intense and more light comes into them. So a lot of the obstacles that we thought were in our way, we're clearing them out now, right? We're clearing them out. We're saying, wow. So it's a shock. You realize that you're free of these obstacles. Wow. There's a lot of wow to what's been said here in this taping. A lot. Because we're lightening up the whole situation and bringing it into perspective here. Obviously, we're talking about what has happened here, what is happening, and what will happen. So we're talking about what we've been involved with, really, is what we're talking about. In one way or the other. You're saying, oh my gosh, that's what was going on. Wow. And we need to see it in a humorous light too. So this is part of it. I'm not mocking anyone. I'm bringing it up into a humorous light and saying, this is what was really happening. Ha! How foolish I was, huh? How foolish I was. Oh, how silly I was. Ridiculous. I didn't even need to do that. I really didn't even need to do that at all. Oh well, you know. So I played my role in the farce a little bit. I play as an actress in a farcical situation. Okay, but I don't need to do that anymore. Yeah, we have to do this. I mean, I look back in my own life, and say, "Oh my God, was I really that stupid?" Yes. Okay. Yes. Okay. But. I had good intentions, you know, and we all do. And so I was just, you know, feeling like, well, I can't drop all attempts to be sophisticated in time, can I? You know, I needed to appear a little bit hip, you know, and so I'm awkwardly trying to be hip, you know, awkwardly, very awkward. My life's been very awkward, you know. It's like, I'm trying to be hip, but I'm really not hip. I really don't want to be hip, you know. I really don't need to do this, but I think I maybe need to do this. And, you know, the fangirls are telling me this is what I should do, and this is they're ready there to applaud, you know, already, like, come on, we're all ready to just think you're the most wonderful thing since sliced bread. And I'm saying, oh man, I don't really want to do this, but, you know, they seem like so eager for me to do this, you know, so awkwardly stumbling along. This is the way most of us are. We're awkwardly stumbling along. And if we're fortunate, we stay out of the clutches of the worst of it, you know. Well, actually, sometimes we do get pulled into the clutches of the worst of it, actually. Maybe that's almost unavoidable at some point, actually. If the new age slick manipulator guru doesn't get you, the goddess will get you. Yeah, actually, they're just working for the goddess, actually. The goddess is the real smooth manipulator, which is a simulation. It's the kind of the booster, the marketer, the ultimate director of marketing of this dream simulation. The director of marketing takes targets you because he realizes, no one else can stop them, you know. Now I've got to convince them what they have to learn how to function in time, and so I have to use all my wiles, you know, and then you eventually get caught up in that. So pretty much you're going to get caught up in something, and now, so looking back, say, oh wow, so that's what it was about. That's okay. I was, you know, it's no shame to be tricked by the ultimate trickster. And it's especially delightful to get free of that ultimate trickster, isn't it? It's a lot of fun. I said, wow, this is fun. Getting free of that ultimate trickster is a lot of fun. I'm enjoying this. Because really, it is rather hilarious how actually transparent and silly the ultimate trickster was. We thought it was some, really incredible trickster, but really, it's just like nonsense, ultimately. Much of gibberish. Oh, you need to do this. Oh, you need to do that. Oh, you got to be good at this. Oh, you have to do this. I'll help you do this, blah, blah. I don't need to do anything. What do you mean you're talking about? I'm the sovereign of this dream. What are you talking about? Like I'm not the god of this dream? Who do you think you are? Well, I'm the goddess of this dream. I'm the god of this dream. That means I created you too. You're a fiction of my own dream. You're part of the dream that I made up. I'm sovereign of this dream. There's no goddess that's prior to this dream that's dreaming me. No, there isn't. Spirit is dreaming the dream. There's no goddess dreaming the dream. Spirit's dreaming the dream. And the goddess is just part of the dream that I'm dreaming. And yet it's claiming that it's sovereign over the dream and I'm not. And that I need to do these things in order to gain some power over circumstances and situations. What absolute hilarity nonsense is that? Hilarious nonsense. Meanwhile, Jesus very humbly, very meekly is calling us and saying, hey, you are sovereign over your dream, absolutely. Not me, he did not say, he said, we are, each one of us has our own dream, as it were. Okay. Perception and valuing is that way. It's all unique. So we have a unique universe, each one of us. So we have to make the decision. Jesus can't do it for us. We have to make the decision to change the purpose of our dream. Jesus cannot do it for us. He can be an advocate to do this, for us to do this, advocate. He's an advocate. He says, yeah, absolutely, you can do this. Don't have to prove anything to do it. You don't have to, what do you need to prove anything to? The goddess? You have to prove to her you're the god of the dream? Why? 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 Otherwise, she's not going to go along with changing the purpose of the dream. Really? That's what she's saying, right? Well, guess what? Got no choice but to go along with it. Oh, but that's, you're forcing yourself upon blah, 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 blah. No, she's got no choice. The dream has no choice. You're sovereign. Well, you're forcing me. Not true. What do you mean? How can a dream figment of your imagination claim that you're forcing it? To change. It has no reality to it whatsoever. It's just an appearance. So we're putting words, stuffing words into the goddess's mouth, to give us all this attitude. And the goddess is full of attitude right now. You can feel in the whole world the goddess attitude is very, very strong in the world right now. They're very full of attitude, aren't they? The ones that are worshipping this idol, they saying, "Oh, you can't change the dream. It's the goddess that's in charge of the dream. You got to worship the goddess, and only then, when she'll bestow her favors upon you." That's what they're saying. They're full of goddess attitude. How dare you? You can't change this dream. That's raping the dream. You're raping the goddess if you do that. No, the entire universe changes like that, and is absolutely gloriously happy to be serving in this way. You cannot rape the light. You cannot. The light is eager to be free of this hideous telling you that it's supposed to be raping you, but time is like a rape of spirit, that this light is serving this purpose. The light it's not thrilled with that at all. I mean, it does what you tell it to do, but it is eager for you to give it this new purpose. The goddess attitude is just more of the same delusion of we got to prepare for time. We got to prepare for time. What are you talking about? You can't not prepare for time. You'll be annihilated if you do that. We're just doing you a favor by pressing this attitude upon you, the goddess attitude, full of attitude. Those who are worshiping the goddess are absolutely overflowing with this attitude, goddess attitude. Like, you must prepare for time. The goddess knows how to prepare for your time. You're crazy if you don't worship the goddess. She's the one who's going to prepare you for time properly, Follow this attitude. So we're getting this intense attitude. We can feel it, too. I can feel it just like, wow, just like that You say, oh, here's another goddess worshiper. Here's another time worshiper. Here's another, and you just feel the attitude like, how dare you insist that you're sovereign over this dream? No, the goddess is sovereign over this dream. She's sovereign over everyone's dream. And you've got to do what she says and that kind of stuff. Total nonsense. The Trinity is the truth, okay? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. There's no goddess in the Trinity at all. Okay, there's God the Prime Creator, God the Prime Created, and the Holy Spirit. That's it. There's not some other principle. God did not create the goddess of time to help you prepare for the kingdom of time. God had nothing to do with this whatsoever. Therefore, it's just a dream. Just a dream. And what right does a dream to have attitude towards the dreamer? This is just dream attitude. It's not real at all. It's not real at all. It's just the attitude that we're giving the dream to try and intimidate ourselves. So we do a little pushback there, and then we just stop. Okay, we don't want to struggle with it, because this is where the attitude is so intense in the world right now. We don't want to struggle with it too much to interfere with the wow that we've gotten in this taping so far. You know, but just touch upon it, and we'll let it go. Let it go. Beautiful day here. We're back into the beautiful weather in California again. We get like a couple days of cloudiness, and we say, what in the heck's going on? Climate change. You know, climate change. You've got cloudiness in California. What the heck is that? So again, full support. Choose the purpose. Your universe. You decide. You're the sovereign. You decide what happens in your kingdom. Kingdom of this dream. Okay? For right now, this dream is your kingdom. Because we're afraid to drop all simulation, all pretending, all preparation, all together like that. So this dream is your dream kingdom, okay? But you decide. You decide. You decide. You're the soul. You're the only one who gave rise to this dream. You're the one who gave rise to this dream. You didn't have a co-creator give rise to this dream. You didn't have co-creator give rise to this dream at all. You tried to say there was a co-creator so you can avoid recognizing that you're sovereign, so you can avoid recognizing you can change the purpose. So that way you keep thinking, I got to keep preparing for time. This is how you do it. You keep thinking that there's a co-creator of this dream. There's a god and a goddess of this dream. And only by them agreeing to change the purpose can you then the purpose change. You have to have an agreement among those co-creators. There's no co-creator of this dream. We're the sole creator of this dream. We're the sole imaginer of this dream. Spirit is the one. God did not co-create this dream with us. We created it on our own. We're imagining it on our own. So there's no one who has to agree with us to change this. There's no one we have to persuade. That's delusion. And maybe, well, let's not complicate it. Let's keep it simple here. That's just good enough. Keeping it simple is good enough, because getting the essentials is what's important. The essential simplicity of this. This is why we practice full stop on the wow, is when we start thinking, well, maybe I can extrapolate this. No, just stay with the simple simplicity. This is what's powerful. There's no co-creator of this dream. Of your dream, there's no co-creator. You're not sharing authority with anyone whatsoever. And those who claim that they have co-authority, that's part of the dream, to try and persuade you not to change his purpose. That's all. You're imagining that too. You're totally imagining that. If there's some co-creator. There isn't. We need to keep emphasizing this. Keep emphasizing. You're the sole creator, sovereign of your dream. There is no co-creator whatsoever. You're not sharing any authority whatsoever. It's impossible. You're the sole authority, the one sole authority of this dream simulation of preparing for time. And you can change the purpose, where it's now a dream simulation preparing for the realization that time will never start. Plain and simple. Which, then that experience is one of complete support for you. Total support. So there's no time to interfere with that support at all. There's nothing that can happen to interfere with this total support of you. And this is what we will experience when we change the purpose of this dream simulation. Universal support. And again, since we're the sole authority of this dream, we're the sole ones who are experiencing this support. We're not sharing it with some other dream, some other authority of the dream. No, we're the ones experiencing it. And each one of us will be able to experience this for ourselves, right? Your unique universe will give you the same support when you change the purpose of a dream simulation. And then we're realizing, hey, we're all experiencing this perfect support. And then ultimately we'll be able to accept the fact that we are truly all one in spirit, in reality. Absolutely. And no need for any preparation or simulation at all, ultimately. But that's beyond the scope of what we're aiming at here, for sure. How are we doing time-wise? Oh, we're doing great. Oh, they're giving me some bonus room here for some reason. Maybe, I don't know why. Maybe because there was so much light in the video. It's just all about how much memory that uses. And so in rendering this to memory card, if it's the background, I think is just like light like this, it uses less memory, something like that. I don't know. Because the time, oh no, I misread it. It's 2:21. Okay, I saw 2:30. It's 2:21. It's hard to see. So yeah, no, everything's normal. Everything's normal. 2:21. So you might be saying, probably you're saying, wow, this is quite a mouthful, you know, earful what I've been hearing here. And it is. It's earful for me too, I tell you. This is just like, wow, why are we getting this now? Wow. Well, because it's the end times. Okay. And they're attempting to criminalize and ultimately kill anybody on this planet who speaks the truth. And is saying, insisting that, you know, each one of us is sole sovereign over our dream. They want to wipe that out. And they're frantically criminalizing it, right, right now at this point. And they're ultimately aiming for, well, they want to kill us, okay? And short of that, they want a severe re-education, including all possible modalities of drugs, of vibrational therapy, of surgery, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They'll say, well, being very humane, we're just giving you a lobotomy, you know, very humane. It'll be like a chemical lobotomy. They won't actually sever your frontal lobes, the connection between, like they used to or whatever. They'll now give you chemicals that will effectively lobotomize you. That's absolutely where they're going. Make no mistake. They say, no, we're not Nazis. We're not going to gas you. We got chemicals that can lobotomize you. And you'll still be alive. And you'll finally recognize that you share authority for this dream. And you need to get permission from this authority. And in fact, you're not even authority to dream at all. And no, that someone else is authority over your dream. And you have to get permission from them, you see, to do anything. You can't change the purpose of the dream. No. That was a crazy delusion of your insane brain, but we've given you the right chemicals so now you see the light the way it really is. This is exactly what this whole world is going towards. It's very much the end times. Jesus is back. Okay, take it from someone who is a friend of Jesus and someone who's trained to help him with his mission. He's back. He's back. He's back. He's back. And he's letting you know, hey, you can go this way. You can go this way. If you want to align with his mission, he has help. He has help for us. Absolutely, he does. It's part of the covenant that he made with us, or the assurance that he gave us. He had assurance. He says, hey, if you are willing to help me out with this mission of helping save a massive amount of floundering in hell, then most certainly you will be capable and ready and willing to sidestep the troubles at the end times. Just remain true to the Trinity. Remain true and clarify it, please. Clarify it. That's what I'm helping you out with here. Clarifying it. And if you say, yeah, I can go along with this, then Jesus has something for us. Jesus has something for us. He's not really spelled it out. He did say, hey, would you like to come visit my place? I said, yeah, where's your place? Is it far away? Real far away? How am I going to get there? He said, no. It's just very close here, actually. Very close. Easy to get to it. So he's certainly intimating that there's some place other than this planet, I would assume. Other than this world here where we can dwell. Most certainly alluded to that without explicitly saying it. Of course, the calmness of Jesus is so profound that you will certainly come to consider his teachings absolutely and say, wow, I feel that this is right. So if you're severely anti-Trinity teaching, say no way, then obviously you're going to feel conflict there and say, wait a minute, I feel like I'm being pressured, too much. I don't want this, and so you may not get an invitation. And that may not be the only place, other traditions may have their places to go to other than this world. That is absolutely possible. Absolutely. Many, many dwelling places. Buddhist teachings talk about the Pure Land, Pure Land Buddhists. All right. And so that's all of that is quite possible. So there may be a mass exodus from this planet, as possible. Those who are from various religious traditions will say, hey, I don't want to be criminalized here and targeted, by this dream and told that I don't have authority to this dream. That's interfering with my, awakening. Absolutely it is. So these secular humanists, these time worshippers may get what they think they want, which is everybody else will leave. Leave them to their own floundering in hell for a while. And maybe that will help them wake up a little bit. I mean, start realizing, wow, maybe I don't have all the answers after all. But they're pretty hard-headed about it, For instance, like the French, for instance, a secular republic, they're quite hard-headed about it. Even they will think once again, choose again, say, wow, wait a minute. I don't really enjoy this floundering, And the goddess is really not getting it done for me. The New Age gurus, the new name they just gave me, it's just like, wow, I think this might go on forever. I think I'm being manipulated here. And I don't think manipulation is the answer. Even if I become a master manipulator, I still don't think that's the answer. Because look at this guru, he's terrified I might leave him or her, and the goddess is afraid I might leave her, the guru is afraid I might leave him. I don't want that. That doesn't feel like perfect support. They seem all insecure. Goddess seems so insecure. The guru seems so insecure. Wow. New Age guru, so I don't think I want that. And of course, you'll be welcome with open arms. Truth always welcomes you with open arms. Absolutely welcome with open arms. But it's not going to change what it is for you. So you have to say, accept truth on its terms. That truth is true and nothing else is true. Those are the terms. That truth is true and nothing else is true. So I've spent 38 years of intense acceptance, working on acceptance to all this, so I can be simpatico with Jesus. Absolutely. 38 years of intense effort. So, I feel comfortable with, truth is true. I accept truth on its own terms, and there's no way around that. So you're going to spend your time one way or the other. Either you're going to try to get simpatico with the New Age guru or the goddess, or you're going to get simpatico with the figurehead of your particular tradition, religious tradition, Or if you're a Christian, trying to get some pot to go with Jesus, absolutely. You're going to try to get some pot to go with someone here. There's no way around it. So you might as well spend intense effort to get simpatico with Jesus, for instance. Absolutely, you should. Everybody's making intense efforts here. Everyone. Those who were trying to get ready for time, they think that they're getting it easy. No, they're making frantic, intense efforts constantly. Spending as much time as possible glued to the television. You don't think that's difficult? That's extraordinarily difficult. It's intense, intense practice and effort. Everybody's making intense efforts here. It's the nature of the situation. So, if you make intense efforts to get simpatico with Jesus, that's a very wise way to use your time. You won't be floundering in hell for very much longer, that's for sure. Alright, we're coming to the end of this video. Wonderful, 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 wonderful. Full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow, and realize, hey,